All right. The time has come. This is the last talk on the blue stage, and of course, here on the red stage is also the last talk. So it's been a pleasure being your host on this stage and announcing all these great speakers. Last but not the least, Maximiliano here is with us, and for the next 35 minutes, he will be your speaker. Of course, do join us for the closing remarks from the Heap Space crew and all the others over there on the rock stage as soon as this talk is wrapped up. Thank you once again from me and from the whole Heap Space community, and you're welcome, of course, to later sing and eat some more with us. See you later.
Voila, thank you. Okay, hello, how are you? Tired? Yeah? Come on, only 30 minutes. 35 minutes left. So, my name is Maximiliano. How many of you have been in my previous talk today? Let's see. Okay, so most of you. Okay, cool. So, I will go quickly then with my presentation. So, Maximiliano is my name. I can go by Max. I've been doing web development since that. Of course, I'm using the same slides for presenting myself, right? That's the first part. So I've been doing this kind of websites and apps, like PWAs, since 1995. Even apps at the time. I'm from Argentina, okay? I have currently arrived from Argentina, but I'm traveling a lot. I've been in 66 different countries, mostly for doing training, consulting, and conferences. I have authored some books on web, the mobile web, and performance. The latest one were on performance. So you can find content that I have authored, including some content on PWAs, progressive web apps, on Safari, and also on LinkedIn Learning. So we're going to talk about PWAs, progressive web apps. First, how many of you are currently creating a progressive web app? Let's see. One. And it's like a half, not really a one, right? Okay, cool. So let's try to define what a PWA is. So it's an innovative new way to create applications for mobile devices. You write apps that look and behave exactly like apps on the phone, and you just put it on an internet server, and that's all. Instant distribution, they're easy to update. You just change the files on your server, and your users will get the update. So PWA, the name, was coined 3 years ago. However, 11 years ago, Steve Jobs basically said those words. The definition that I gave you is not the one from 3 years ago. It's from 11 years ago. So he was talking about one last thing, WWDC 07, on how to create apps for the iPhone, okay, for the first original iPhone. It was an innovative new way to create applications for mobile devices, Web 2.0, remember that? Easy to update, secure, instant distribution. So this is not new, okay? So you can see this is, I mean, the idea is old. No SDK required, so no native apps, okay? In fact, it's not. This is not ending with Apple 11 years ago. 19 years ago, Microsoft created something called HTAs, HTML applications, which is pretty much the same thing, okay? The ability to execute HTAs was introduced with IE5, okay? So, and by the way, it seems like the technology was patented. Weird. Anyway, so the idea of creating mobile apps or apps, but using web technologies is not new. But 0 years ago, so this year, is known as the year of PWA. So we will see why, but it has to do with compatibility, that now it works everywhere. It has to do with big companies and big names creating progressive web apps, for example, including Facebook, Twitter, Tinder, Uber, Lyft, and many others. And I really like the cover of this magazine, so I authored the article, but not because of that, because I like the idea of the DNA. Because PWA is just the new or the current DNA of the web. So we are still talking about the web. It's not something different. It's not a completely different platform. It's just the web platform. It's how you create websites and web apps. But now we have some advantages, some new APIs that will let us create better experiences. So it's ideal for all those apps that are out there that probably you are creating they're just consuming web content on web services. So if you think about this, there are a lot of apps in the store right now. They're just downloading a JSON file from a server and rendering that on a page. So you're basically, if you create a native app for that, you're basically creating a browser, a custom browser for your content only, which at one point doesn't make too much sense. So why are we doing this? Probably because we didn't have any other good options, and now we have with PWAs. So we are full of these things. Like, for example, you receive a LinkedIn contact, and you click accept, and then the website is telling you, no, no, it's faster on our mobile app. Please get out of here. But when you look, the mobile app is 132 megabytes. So how is that faster? Also, every VR or AR experience out there requires downloading a native app. And because I'm traveling a lot, I'm always using services. For example, in this case, this is Ukraine, and I was trying to understand oils of what I was buying. So I'm using an app that is, in this case, is Translate, Google Translate, that is translating on the fly. But I need a native app. I need to download 100, 200 megabytes, maybe on roaming. So I'm paying for that data. And it's not necessary. We can actually do this with a web platform without any problem today. Also airports. So during the last 5 years, I've been on more than 100 different airports. So do I need to download 100 apps that maybe I use only once? Doesn't make any sense. But I still want the rich capabilities of that app. For example, I still want to get notified if there is a gate change, or I want to know if there is a discount or any information that is interesting for the airport. So we ended up with a lot of apps that then your phone needs to update every week, okay, or every couple of days. So if you try to disable automatic updates and wait a week and then wait a month, you will see hundreds of apps asking for an update. That means you are downloading gigabytes of information, and maybe you're not using those apps anymore. Okay? And the last example I have for you, I arrived to Belgrade. This is my first time in Serbia, using Air Serbia. And they have Wi-Fi on board. Okay? And you say, oh, cool, they have an app or a system where you can actually see movies for free. Okay? They actually say for free, so it's really cool. But then you realize that you need an app. You just see a video, right? So you need an app, and if you're on an iOS, you need to actually purchase a Wi-Fi package. You need to pay for Wi-Fi to download the app that is free to access free content. So it doesn't make any sense. Also, when you look at the Wi-Fi pricing, but it's not Wi-Fi, by the way, it's Wi-Fi. But if you look at the price, you can see, I'm not sure if you see that, but it's 10 megabytes for, I think it's like 3 euros, or 20 megabytes for 5 euros. And of course, you have more expensive plans, but which plan should I use? I don't know beforehand which plan is necessary to download that app. Okay, but let's say that I can manage to get the size of the app. It's 16 megabytes, so it's 20 enough? 20 megabytes enough? I don't know, because I need to get to the store. First, when I connect to the Wi-Fi, my phone starts doing a lot of things in the background, downloading things, so I don't know the megabytes that it's going to use. And also, I need to get to the App Store, downloading the banners, the animations, and I'm not sure if 20 is going to be enough. And by the way, if you buy the package and you try to download the app on iOS, there is a problem. The app was removed from the App Store. I don't know why, okay? But it's not in the App Store. So basically, you pay for a data plan that then you couldn't use to download the app to access free content. It doesn't make any sense. And this is just an example. There are many examples like this that really don't make any sense. So we need to do something. And PWAs and Progressive Web Apps is a solution. So let's talk about the state of the platform. So, because I'm not sure if you have ever seen a PWA before, okay? So, first, a progressive web app is just a website. Okay? So basically, it works on every web platform, every web browser. But typically, when we are talking about this, we don't want to say it's just a browser. We want to understand where, in which platforms, can we actually install the app, and then it has, it's really a native app, or it looks like a native app. So this is the current compatibility. On Android, it's available on mostly all the browsers. Chrome, Firefox, Opera, Samsung, UC Web, and even Edge. Edge is available on Android. If you browse a PWA with Edge, you can install also the app. On iOS, on iPhone, and iPad, it's available since iOS 11.3. So you can actually install PWAs. And then you have KaiOS or Geo. Have you ever heard about that? KaiOS. Remember this one? Matrix. Okay. So this is the classical revival from Nokia. It's running KaiOS. KaiOS is based on Firefox OS, so it's basically web-based. Okay, it's pretty much web-based. And all the apps that you can develop for this are just HTML5 apps or PWAs. It supports service workers, and it supports all the technologies of PWAs. There is no native SDK for this. This is a phone that you can get here in this region, including Serbia, for around 70 euros, okay, unlocked. So that's the idea of these phones. Okay, so if you want to create apps for this, it's PWA. So that's for desktop, but that's for mobile, I'm sorry. We will see desktop in a minute. Let's see this in action. But you need to understand, before doing that, that when you are browsing the web with Facebook, you are inside Facebook and you click on a link, that's not Chrome, that's not Safari. Okay, so that means no PWAs there. So careful with when you are based mainly on social media, you might have a problem with PWAs. So let's see this in action. This is Android. You go to a website, for example, Financial Times, appapp.ft.com. It's a website. Okay, but if you go to the little three dots at the top right, you can actually add it to the home screen. And when you do that, it will install what it seems to be a shortcut. Okay, but it's not. It's more than that. And now it's installed. It's basically it's doing something in the background. It's compiling an APK, an actual Android package, on a server. And now it's installed, not just in the home screen, but also in the launcher. You have now a kind of native experience. From every point of view, it looks like a native app, okay, on Android. You can even, for example, go to Settings, Apps, and it will appear there with battery usage, with all the information, and even the phone, your phone, will think that the app was downloaded from the Play Store, which is not really true. So it looks like any other app in the system. What about iOS? Pretty similar. I'm not sure if you have heard about a website known as Tinder. Haven't heard about that. Probably you don't. So Tinder has a PWA. So if you go on your iPhone on Tinder, you can also add it to the home screen. And if you're an iPhone user, you think, oh, that's a shortcut to the website. But it's kind of, because if you open now that icon, it's a full screen experience. It's outside of Safari. And from an OS point of view, you will see it looks like the Tinder app. But it didn't come from the place, from the iOS App Store, not the Play Store. Okay? It's just a website that now has superpowers. Of course, Hobbycraft, it's a UK, it's a website from UK, also has a PWA, so you can also do that and install the app. Uber is also a PWA, and many others. So what about desktop? This is kind of new, because PWAs are not just for mobile devices. Right now, if you have a Chromebook, that's Chrome OS, you have support for progressive web apps. Windows 10, and that's new from this week, has added support using Chrome 70. That's the last version of Chrome with Windows 10, not just 10, also 7 and 8. So if you're using Chrome on Windows 7, 8, or Windows 10, you can actually install apps also on Windows. By the way, these apps work offline without connection. It's up to the developer to do that, but it's possible they have push notifications and access to a lot of hardware and sensors. Also on Windows 10, using the Edge HTML engine, you can access your PWA from the store. For example, if you're a Windows 10 user, you can go to the store and download the Twitter app. the Twitter app is actually a PWA. And it's the same code base that is actually running in the Twitter app here. Okay, so it's exactly the same code base. What about Mac and Linux? It's available through a flag in Chrome. So you can try it, but it's an experiment. It will be available in January, in the next two versions, in 72, Chrome 72. Okay, so it will be available also for Linux and Mac, but you can try it today if you enable a flag. So this is the desktop experience. This is a Chromebook. So I'm on Twitter. Twitter is a PWA, but I can install the app. So I can use it in the browser, but I can also install it. And when I do that, when I install the app, now it has its own window, its own desktop window. And it appears everywhere where apps appear, in the launcher, in the dock, or in the taskbar. It depends on the OS, the names. You can resize the window, so a responsive web design will take charge of the UI of your app. Remember that one, that game? Flappy Birds, so that's progressivewebflap.com. It's a PWA. And the same Financial Times, okay, works also here. They have a CSS problem there, so don't tell anyone. And you can make your windows as small or big as you want, and you can open more than one progressive web app, okay? So that's the idea. So, you have the URL bar, or the title bar, has information about the SSL certificate. So if you want to know the current, because you don't have a URL bar, so you can see that. There is a quick, small menu. For example, this is the Starbucks progressive web app from UK and US. And from there, for example, if it's trying to get your geolocation, you will actually see a little icon in the title bar saying that, hey, this app is using your geolocation. So this is the desktop experience for progressive web apps. And this is this week, Windows. So I'm in Trivago that has a progressive web app. So I can install Trivago from the menu. And then now it's a Windows 10 app. It's installed. It has its own window. You can, of course, resize it. It looks exactly the same as in Chromebooks. Also, it's in the start screen. So you can search for Trivago. It's installed. Okay, like any other app. So now you can actually create simple apps or complex apps also, but without actually creating an executable or a universal app for Windows, it's just a PWA. That's the same Starbucks app that we saw before. You can open Tinder. Okay, you can install as many PWAs as you want. And because there is no store involved here, you can do private apps, apps for your company, okay, apps that cannot be in the store, okay, for your employees, or if you want, okay, but you can actually get out of store requirements. And also, this is available again on Windows 7 and Windows 8. So there you have the same Starbucks PWA installed in a Windows 7 computer. And for Linux and Mac, you just go to Chrome Flags and enable desktop PWAs. And you can try it also today. So you go to one of these PWAs, and you go to the menu and install it and see how the experience looks like. This will be available, again, in two versions. That's January. So now let's talk about some little secrets that you need to know to create a real good experience. Because everything sounds pretty good, but if you don't know what you're doing and if you don't try and test a lot, you might end up with a bad user experience. And of course, we don't want that. So I have here for the next, say, 16 minutes, a couple of secrets, okay, to make a better user experience for your PWA users. So I'm going to start talking about installations. Because if this is the first time you're seeing an actual PWA, probably you thought this a couple of minutes ago. Who is going to know that if you go to the three little dots, you can install an app? Because no one knows that. And that's a fair question, a fair problem. So let's see how to work with this. First, if you follow something known as a PWA criteria, so if you're using some APIs in your website, it's HTTPS, you have a service worker with a fetch handler. If you know what it is, it has to do with service workers. If you have a web app manifest, it's a JSON file with metadata. The browser will show you a hint or a web app banner asking the user to download or install the app. Some browsers are requiring some engagement with your content. That is, the first time the user is accessing the content, it's not showing the banner. But the second time, the browser says, oh, maybe this user wants to install the app. So it's suggesting the user to install the app with different UI, different hints. And also, there is, a problem going on with the verb add or install. Okay, on desktop, it's use install. On Android, it's using right now add to home screen, not install, which is kind of weird. Okay. And also, there is something called batching. Let me show you how this works. On Chrome, on Android, you need to select add to home screen. Okay, but also, Chrome will show you that little hint now when you are in a PWA. Samsung Internet Browser, when you are in a PWA, is changing the URL bar with that icon. It's like a home, add to the home. Okay? Opera, it's saying home screen with an icon of the phone. This is Firefox on Android. It's showing you that nice banner that appears there with another icon. Edge is just saying add to home screen. And also, Edge for Windows has announced that in the future, it will also have its own icon in the URL bar, so you can install an actual PWA. So the problem is that today we have different badges. There is no standard, okay, for your user to understand that that's an installable app, not just a normal website. So fortunately, today, we have the ability to add our own install UI. And that's something you need to do, because your user will never know that that app is installable. So to do that, you need to listen for an event known as before install prompt. Basically, on that event, you are going to enable the button. That event means that the installation action is available. And then you prevent default, so nothing will happen. And you will save in a local variable the argument that you receive. Later, in a button, you add a handler. And you use that variable that you saved, and you actually call prompt. And that will basically trigger the installation dialog, the native installation dialog. Talking about the user interface, you know that on the web, you can do pull to refresh like this. Okay, but maybe on an app, you might have a problem when you have your own gestures. Okay, so if you want, with just some CSS, you can adjust that behavior and reduce or delete the ability for the browser to do that pull to refresh when it's an app, okay, and not a website. Also, app translations. So today, when you are in Android with Chrome, you know that Chrome is trying to translate your website, your content, when the website language is not matching the user language. The problem is that that's OK with a website, but what about an app? It's also doing that with an app. So it might translate the whole app, which maybe it might be doing conflict with your current translation system. Okay, so what you can do if you want is you can disable that. It's a metadata, so you can disable translation. When you do that, it's also going to disable translation when you are in the browser. So maybe you want to do something like this. Using JavaScript, you can query the current situation. Are we in the browser, or are we in a standalone app? And if we are in a standalone app, we can inject the metadata. Okay, so just a little trick. Fighting challenges. So what is this? There are some challenges on Android and on iOS that you need to understand. So first, let's talk about Android. On Android, there is something since for about a year, we had this thing known as Web APK. When you're actually adding to the home screen, Google's servers are creating an actual APK, an Android package, available Android package. Don't get me wrong, that package is not including your HTML, JavaScript, and CSS files. It's just a launcher. That launcher is being signed by Google, so that's why your phone is going to install that APK, even if it's not coming from the Play Store, and even if you don't enable unsecure context or unsecure sources. So your users don't need to do anything, and that APK will be installed. The problem with that Web APK, not a problem, it's a feature, but you need to understand what's going on, is that link capturing is enabled. And what is that? That means that your PWA now, when it's installed on Android, it will be the owner of your domain. It will be the owner of your origin, which means, for example, this is housing.com, a PWA from India. If you search for something on housing.com, I don't know why the video is stopped. There we are. So, and you click on Google, that maybe it's not part of the PWA, but if it's that result is in housing.com, the PWA will open that in a standalone mode. And maybe you don't have a back button, you don't have navigation, so it's not working. So what I'm saying is, for example, if you send an email to your users with a new promotion, and on the email says, see our terms and conditions, if the user to a PDF, if the user clicks there, if it's part of your domain, that is in your domain, the PDF will open in the standalone mode and not in the browser. So your PWA is now owning your domain. It's the owner of your domain. By the way, I'm saying it wrong. It's not really your domain. It's your scope. But because I don't know yet if you are in PWAs or not, there is something known as a scope. It can be the full domain, a full origin, or it can be a path inside an origin. So on iOS, and here we have a couple of minutes on challenges on iOS. So iOS started to support progressive web apps in iOS 11.3. In fact, if you Google iOS PWA, you will find my article that says, Cupertino, we have a problem. Because there are a lot of challenges on iOS for PWAs that you need to know to create a good experience. So, for example, do you know Narendra Modi? He's the Prime Minister of India. And why I'm talking about that? Because he's the first head of state with a PWA. He even tweeted about that, talking about PWAs. So, for example, first, I don't know why, but when you install the PWA, the content of the PWA is asking you if you want to install the native app, which doesn't make any sense. If I already have the PWA, why I want to go to the store? But anyway, problems with this PWA. For example, it doesn't have any launch image, so you see just white. Okay. Other problems, if you look there at the bottom, okay, you can see it has a tab bar design. The problem is in an iPhone X, so iPhone with notch, with a notch, they're using the lower space, in fact, that part for gestures, OS gestures. So you cannot use that space for your own UI. So basically, if you tap there, it's not going to work. So you need to tap on those icons, but on the app part of that. So it has a design issue. There is a very big problem, a US issue, UX issue on those devices. To solve the problem, you need to use a new way to create to use environmental variables. So you can create, you can use margins or paddings. It depends on what you're designing, using safe area. Okay, and this is also not for iOS. It works also with the Android devices with a notch. And also, you need to add viewport fit cover to your viewport meta tag if you want to use the whole space of the screen. So things that you need to understand to make a good experience. Also, on iOS, on iPhone, you know that there is no back button. So we don't have a physical back button or a virtual back button. So you need to provide that button on your own interface. So that's the Twitter PWA. And when you get to some place, there is no back button. So no way to go back. You need to just kill the app and start it again. By the way, you need to define launch images. So because if not, when you open the app, or when you look at the multitasking mode, or the, let's say, open app, that's not the right name, but you will see just white. So you need to define your Apple Touch startup images for every phone. Okay, so every iPhone, you need to create a bitmap. If not, you're just seeing white. The problem is that there are so many sizes that you need to cover. And I think I need to add one there. That's the new iPhone X Max. So there is a library that you can start playing with, it's called PWA Compat from the Chrome team, that will create those launch images for you. My opinion, they will look like this. OK, Okay, they will create the launch images for you. My opinion is that you shouldn't use this library, but anyway. To start, at least for a starter, is okay. But then you should create your own system for creating those launch images. Some companies, such as Starbucks, made a decision. You know what? We are going to remove support for iOS, for PWAs, until they resolve some issues. Because I haven't talked about all the issues. For example, every time you get out of the app and you get again, it reloads. So basically, the system is killing your process every time the user is getting out of the PWA. So it's kind of a problem because you get out, you go back, and it reloads all the time, and other issues. So this is the web app manifest for Starbucks. When you are in Android, it says standalone, so it's a PWA. But when it's an iPhone, it says browser. And if you know the web manifest, that means it's not going to be a PWA. It will create an icon, but it will open in Safari, not as a standalone app. Okay? And finally, I would like to talk about app stores. Because some people really want to be in the app store. And when you go to a client and say, I want to create a PWA for you, they say, oh, but I want to be in the app store. My users are finding me in the app store. Even if it's true or no, it doesn't matter. So Twitter Lite, Google Maps Go, Instagram Lite are current apps in the App Store, and they are PWAs. So, but they are currently using the view and a lot of native code. So, not for the UI. The UI is actually HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, but they have a lot of native code supporting that. So it's like a PhoneGap or Cordova app. So they are kind of using a mixed solution for their PWAs. Later this year, Chrome is releasing something, it's going to release something known as Trusted Web Activities that will let us create our own APK that will launch the PWA using the Chrome engine. Okay? So it's coming. Today you can test it with the dev, Chrome dev edition on Android. Okay? So later this year, we will be able to publish a PWA in the store without actually creating a lot of native code, just the launcher. And Microsoft is also supporting PWA for Windows 10, on the store. KaiOS, it's supporting the store, and it's coming. Play Store, and with Trusted Web Activities. And what about App Store? Well, Apple Pro is not going to support this directly. If you want to create a PWA and then distribute in the App Store, you need to use a web view. So Cordova or other framework like that. And you are going to fight with an App Store rule saying that you should not publish a website. You should not wrap a website and go to the store with a website. Just keep it as a website. Okay? But anyway, you can still do that, but maybe you might have problems with App Store rules. So PWAs are great, okay? But let's use a critical eye because there are some things that might go wrong if you don't know what you're doing. And remember, Our goals is just to create a good, accessible, and performant user experience, which means remember your user. So if your current app is suitable for a PWA, maybe it's a good idea to create a PWA. For example, the Air Serbia app to watch movies. Okay, the current user experience is really bad. It's broken. Actually, and it's also making me pay for a broken experience, so it makes no sense. But also, there are other apps that might not be still suitable for PWA. So it depends, okay, which solution is the best one. So that's all I have for you. Thank you.